tuning in today. It's really exciting because we've got Rory Lees-Oakes from Counselling Tutor, and anyone that is a practicing counsellor or a counselling student has probably swung by Rory on YouTube or used some of the amazing Counselling Tutor resources. And Rory's the co-founder of Counselling Tutor, and it's great to have you here. I've watched so many of your YouTube, so yeah, it's lovely to have you here today.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be invited on your YouTube channel and be interviewed by you. So thank you very much for the invitation.
Oh, no worries. And I thought it'd be an interesting time to speak to you because I'm currently doing my level four, like many students, juggling life, becoming a mum in the middle of all this level four, has kept it interesting. I'm interested to see just what you think about the journey of counselling training and any kind of advice that we can look at for students like myself. And then particularly at the moment when we're filming this because of COVID, and it's really thrown the face-to-face standard model of counselling into question. So it'd be interesting for us to touch on that as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, in terms of the journey, you know, I think that one of the questions that people ask about counselling training is, you know, what's it like? How long is it going to take? And if I were to proffer an observation on anybody who wants to start counselling training, is don't have too much of a romantic view of it. I think a lot of people, not particularly people who've had a lot of therapy, but I think people who may not have been involved in counselling may have a kind of over romantic view. I'll share a little story from when I was a teacher, if I may. Mm-hmm. And I was in my office one day drinking tea and looking out of the window, which I used to do a lot of when I was teaching. You look out the window and look for inspiration. And I got a phone call from Learner Services, kind of speak to a student who's interested in doing a counselling course. And I said, yes, they went down. It was a guy. And I said, hi, I'm Rory. I'm the course leader. I shook his hand and he went, you're the teacher of counselling. And I went, yeah. And he went, I was expecting a woman. And then he paused and said, in a dress. And I said, well, I'm sorry to disappoint you. I said, I only wear dresses on Sunday. But I'm a male therapist. And it does go to the point, there is a very stereotypical view of what counsellors are. The media generates it. You look into things like films or on the TV, and you would think that it was a certain class of person that was a counsellor, mainly female, lots of scarf wearing. And in fact, we're a very diverse bunch, as you know, I am an example of. So not to have too much of a romantic view of it, which is why when people do 10-week courses, there's a big fallout from those. A lot of people don't continue up to do the certificate. When I did my training, I did a 10-week course, as a lot of people do, and there's four of those run in the college I was attending every year. And I was the only person from my cohort of 15 who went to do the certificate. And there was only three of us who went from the certificate to the diploma. The dropout rate is phenomenal.
Wow.
And when we came to be interviewed for the diploma, there was 45 people and 15 of us were chosen.
Okay,
wow. So I guess that my view would be is that counselling is a very, very tough, very demanding profession. Mm. It is not like any other form, and you may know this yourself. You know, there are lots of people who've done degrees and said, oh, wow, a level four counselling course is so much more tougher, so tougher.
Yeah.
And it is, and it needs to be because, you know, you're working with people who can be in the pit of despair, and you need to be strong enough, emotionally robust enough to be able to hold them and you in that moment. So when I used to do the induction, when people come for the information session for the diploma, I would try my best to put them off, if I was honest. And I would tell them the truth. I didn't actively stop people joining, but I would tell them the truth. And what a part of that truth is that a lot of relationships don't last the diploma training. Certainly my cohort, when I train, I think half the people there separated from their partners, and they do call it the divorce diploma.
I've never heard that term before, but I do know that it can really shake your life up, put you in the washing machine and spit you back out.
Absolutely. And I know lots of people who've come to the end of their diploma and have moved on. And in fact, in my own case, it made my relationship with my wife a lot stronger, because there were things I had to sit down and look at myself and my behaviour. I don't want to give the impression that I'm a bad person or a terrible, abusive person. I wasn't. But there are things where I had to realise how my behaviour impacted. And we had a long conversation, and happily, 20 years on, we're still together, and it's a work in progress. So you asked the question about counselling training. It's a tough, demanding discipline, and rightly so.
Yeah, like you say, I think that a lot of people go into it at the beginning and there's these different stages, because I'm doing a CPCAB course, and so you've got your introduction, then you go on to your level 3, and then your level 4, which is 2 years part-time, but like you say, it's mentally very, very demanding, and it doesn't, like actual therapy, it doesn't stop just on the time you're on the course. All the time, you know, you'll be going to sleep at night, you'll be thinking about your own defense mechanisms or patterns of relating or all these different things that it's really full on. And I think, like you say, it ripples out onto your relationships. And I know even with my mum, my relationship, it had a ripple effect. So it's not to be entered into lightly, but great growth as well.
It's a great opportunity for growth. It's when, you know, people ask me about the significant things in my life, I would say meeting my wife and getting married, birth of our daughter, up to the arrival of my grandchildren. I would have said completing the diploma were the three most incredible things that have ever happened to me. I now have two lovely grandchildren, so I can add that to the list. But generally speaking, it was life changing. It changed my life forever. And I can remember right at the end of class, we all went out for a drink, and we went up to Wernthlow, which is a very, very great high point in Manchester. It's quite high above sea level. You can see across to Manchester and across to Warrington. You can see the cooling towers at Warrington. And I remember sitting there looking as far as the eye could see and thinking, my life will change forever. You know, this is the first day of the rest of my life. And boy, was I right. My life did change forever. It wasn't a straightforward journey, but it was one of the best things I ever did, was become a counsellor, take the qualification. It was a life-changing event for me.
Yeah, I can relate to all of those things, because I feel the same, that it's something where it's not just training for a job. It's so much more than that. And obviously there is the professional side that you want to potentially use it in a career as a counsellor, or you can go into all other kinds of related jobs where the skills will help. But just as a person, and I think becoming a mum as well, it really helps you with those everyday, just living as a person, as well as the potential to have it as a career.
Yes, and I think one of the reasons for that is you think psychologically. Mm. So having an understanding of psychological development from different perspectives, you know, helps you understand why people behave in the way they do. And I think that can take a lot of the emotion out of situations. One of the things that I always talk about is, I think, well, it's not my phrase, is I did coin the term divorce diploma, but the phrase of all behaviour is goal directed, of course, comes from Carl Rogers, and understanding that when people behave, even in ways that may not be not be good or disruptive. There is a reason they behave in that way. And if you can work out the reason, then you can work out how you can build a relationship. And I think it gives you this, I think that counselling training gives you the psychological tools to be able to do that. And my wife's always saying to me, you know, my wife hasn't trained as a counsellor, although she would be a very good counsellor, but she's not trained. She says, "You're so philosophical, Rory. You're so philosophical." And it's not a case of being philosophical. It's realizing that all behavior is driven towards a goal. And within that, you have to show compassion. When people act out, I mean, they're saying now in schools, they're changing challenging behaviour to distressed behaviour. And I think that's a great shift.
Yeah.
Because if someone's acting out, they're acting out because they're distressed and they're projecting that distress. It may be anger, it may be violence, it may be being withdrawn, but it's distressed behaviour. And if you can understand that there's a goal directed to it, then you've got the opportunity to help that person and try and find out what's going on. It's what I live my life to. It's not always easy, I have to say.
No, definitely not. And what you were just saying then, that's amazing about that distress behaviour, because I was listening to something the other day and it was saying about when, I guess it can apply to anyone, but it was talking about a child. If a child is acting out, having a tantrum or doing something that you don't like, and then the Western kind of traditional way that we think about it now is that you then tell them to go to their room or time out, and you withdraw from them, when actually that's the time when, you know, you really need to be with them. Like, we need a container and help them to work through what it is, and then it's less likely to keep on happening and keep on happening because you're acknowledging it.
Yeah, and it takes courage to be able to step back and think psychologically. It takes some time. I don't get it right all the time, but I'll give an example of something that happened recently to me, if that would be useful.
Yeah.
Our daughter had visited, and as she was leaving, someone on a bicycle shot past without looking, and she nearly ran this person over. The cyclist was clearly at fault. Mm-hmm. And my daughter, out of kind of stress response, said, "You idiot, you nearly got killed." And this guy got off his bike, threw his bike down, and he was shouting and threatening all this. And I went up to him, and you could see could have got out of hand. I mean, I sound like I live in the Bronx, but I live in a very quiet part of the world. And I just said to him, "It's okay, you're safe, you're all right." And he just stopped. I just said, "You're okay, man." I said, "You're all right. You're frightened because you nearly got run over. You don't like someone telling you off. She was just worried that you were going to get hurt. It's okay." And he literally stopped in his tracks. And he was a different person.
Yeah.
And that was just understanding that behaviour is goal-directed. You know, it did help I was bigger than him, I think. But...
him because he would have been so used to somebody coming in with that response of just mirroring him, whereas you kind of broke that and probably disrupted what he thought was going to happen.
Yeah. And he went away and he was all right. And we said, "Just take care of yourself, man. Just, you know, be careful on your bike because cars can hurt you." And every time he cycles past, he gives me a wave. Which is nice if you see him. Yeah. So yeah, it does equip you with skills to look to be introspective of self and to be thoughtful of others. I've always said it's a way of being, not a way of doing. It integrates into it. If it's taught properly and people are passionate about it, I think it integrates into it, becomes who you are.
Yeah. Like you say, it's so much bigger than like a career or a job. And one of the things that I was interested in asking you about, and probably a good point to mention it now, is, you know, I went into the training, I tried to look as much as I could on YouTube and around for people talking about what it was like doing the training. And one of the things that came up quite a few times was, you know, don't be getting into it thinking that you're going to make a ton of money or whatever. And a lot of people were saying that, you know, people do the training, and then are there the jobs for people? because as much as you want it to impact and improve your own life, I think some people sometimes were questioning, like, what do you do with it? So when I finish my level 4 diploma, what chances have I got of kind of having a career and actually using the training for something? And I was just interested in your experience of working with students and what you...
Well, I think one of the interesting things is I taught for a long time, and you can pretty much tell if you're an experienced tutor. I may get other tutors who change, have a different view, but if you're an experienced tutor, you can tell the people who will be successful as a therapist on the level 2 introduction course after the first 2 weeks.
Wow.
You can sit and look at them and you can say they're going to be brilliant. And one of the things that, one of the essences that I look for when I used to interview, I used to say, why do you want to become a counsellor? And I'd have lots of people say, I want a good job and I want to do this. I did have someone once say, I want to wear nice clothes, which I thought was a bit odd, and they didn't get on the course for a number of reasons. Well, I like the idea of dressing up and thinking, okay, well, maybe this isn't the right course for you. But hearing those words of, I want to help, I want to be in service to others, is the essence of our craft. It's the essence of our profession. And those people who want to be in service to others, who it's really meaningful to, always get jobs, would be my observation. I've got a very dear friend who I taught on level 2. She was brilliant. I could see that she was going to be an exceptional therapist because of her way of being and her need to be able to want to support and love humans in a helping way. And I'm pleased to say that I taught her, she graduated, she went off, she got more qualifications than me. She sometimes teases me and says, you know, I've got a degree, Rory. And I'm like, oh, very good. We talked together, we team talked together, great experience. And then she went on to be a senior manager at a children's home, clinical lead, exceptional person, a dear friend. But I could have told you after the second week that she'd do that. And everybody who really wants to be in service to people, who cares about people, cares about humanity, they all seem to get jobs. Go figure.
Well, that's
the people who say, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it's
really, yeah, they may not
get, sorry, go on. Carry on, Rory.
They may not get full-time jobs, but they all get jobs. I've got someone who's head of services. I've got people in recovery. I say I've got people in recovery. I know people who are working in recovery. I've got someone who co-runs Counselling Tutor with me, Ken, my business partner. I taught him, and I could think of someone who emailed me this morning who works as a child therapist. All of them, I could have told you from the second week of level 2 that they were going to be successful therapists.
It's so moving to hear you talk about that. I feel like I'm about to start my placement just next week, actually. And that's what I feel like is where the magic happens, to use that phrase, is like when you're able to be with someone, this will be online to start off with, but just that feeling that you're helping somebody and that you're able to just have that really special time where they may never have had that before. And I personally had never had that experience before until I had counselling, where you're just in a room with somebody and all they want to do is just to give you space to be yourself, not be judged, and they just listen and they don't try and fix or tell you need to do X, Y, and Z or do this better or do this differently. And that was... That was really an amazing feeling, which is, you can't really describe, but.
Absolutely. And as I wrote in my book, a bit of a sly plug for my book,
Yeah,
okay. I can't remember the name of my book now. How embarrassing. Counselling Theory and Practice, a Student's Guide. I taught criminology. I taught all the psychology, and it's in a criminology course many years ago. And I remember the students all moaning and groaning and puffing and panting. There's no jobs, rubbish qualification. And he went on and on and on and on. And I said to them, I am so pleased that you think like that. And he went, why? I said, because I'll never have to be in competition against you for a job. You've defeated yourself already. And in came someone late, waltzed in late. And I said, oh, late again, Tom. We'll call him Tom. It wasn't his name. And he said, yeah, I've just got into the fire service. And I said, how have you done that? And he was a public services course that I was teaching, and criminology was the module. And he was just passionate about it. He'd done everything. He used to run around the college, getting fit. You'd see him jogging around the college. You'd see him taking extra classes to get his literacy up. He would just do everything. And he got into one of the toughest professions you can have. Being a firefighter is an elite profession. And he got in, not because he was cleverer than everyone else. He had a passion for it. And I think that's what carries people through. The certificate is very nice. Stick it on your wall. But it's the passion that your clients want. It's the passion that drives you when you're struggling to make ends meet, but you still want to teach, you still want to be a therapist. That is how people get jobs. Bit of a speech there, Ruth.
No, it was fantastic, because I think it's one of those things where sometimes it almost feels to me like it's been skirted around a little bit as a topic. And sometimes I feel like tutors don't go that in depth on it. And I just think it's good to hear. And also, like you say, not having this very fixed idea of I'm going to be one of those stereotypical counsellors in this stereotypical room that you see on a movie or on a TV show. It may be that you're using those skills, but it might be working in mental health in a different area. It could be within wellbeing, you know, with children, in schools, in the police, you know, private practice. There's so many areas that you can find your way to. It might not be a straightforward path, but that's what I'm hoping for me anyway, that it'll just organically evolve rather than trying to be very specific.
And I think it's a case of go with the flow. I was speaking to a colleague I taught years ago. She's not in practice now, but she manages she manages practitioners, most of whom I taught, which are kind of, they call themselves Rory's Angels. Which I thought was, I got quite kind of embarrassed about, to be honest, because, you know, it's not the place I come from, really. I always encouraged students to be themselves, but I think it's a term of endearment, and I'm grateful they think of themselves in that way. But again, another case of somebody who you could see was just going to be brilliant at a certain task. And she's still working in counselling. It's just that she does the more of the managerial aspects of it. She's brilliant. It's a strange thing. I'm sure there's going to be lots of students listening to this who's going, I'm going to ask my tutor if she thinks he or she thinks I'm a natural counsellor. Don't do that. That's not fair. And certainly if someone asked me, I would have just said you need to do the training. But privately in the staff room, you could pick the stars out very early on.
Yeah, that's lovely to hear that there's the hard work to do, but there's also like a natural element to it, I find. And anyone that I've had counselling from, or other people on my course, like you say, even as a student amongst your peers, you really get that... You just get that feeling with some people that I think everyone's got gifts in different ways. And one of the other things that I was going to ask you about was just because you've got your own style. And I think that's why you're so successful on YouTube. Counselling Tutor's been so successful. I know you're not going to blow your own trumpet, but you're like down to earth and, you know, says it in a way that just makes everyone feel kind of like they can just breathe. Oh, I'm not getting taught and just you're just chatting and the knowledge is easily absorbed. And I think that it's important for every sort of student to know that it's okay to have your own style, because it can be hard when you're amongst your peers and you're thinking, should I be more like him? Oh, she's more like this. It can be quite tricky.
Yeah, I always used to love the final about 6 months of the diploma course, because you get students kind of arguing the toss with you. Well, I don't think that's right. And they used to sit there, and well, why are you laughing, Rory? And I said, because you're thinking for yourself. You're now your own people. You're not a clone of who taught you. You are who you are. And the very fact, we used to have this, you know, I don't think you could say this in education anymore. I used to say it's the arsey lessons, becoming arsey, you know. And right at the end, they were practitioners in their own right. They were colleagues who, you know, they may be just at the beginning of their practice, but they had firm views on things based in analysis, ethics and theory. So it was always a joy to get to, usually about this time in the year, when March, we're coming up to Easter, you would start to get the rise of people really showing who they are and their own style. And it's a joy to see. It really is.
Yeah, that's what I think. It's like everything. There's different people are going to be drawn to different types of counsellors. And that's where it's good that there's not that stereotype of it's always a middle-aged woman in a scarf.
Yes. Not there's anything wrong with middle-aged women in scarves.
No, there's definitely not.
I get any letters.
I've had some great counsellors that are very much that, you know, picture that you have of a counsellor. But I told someone that I was doing the training and he was like, oh, I'm really surprised, because he said, I thought it was always older women that became counsellors. And I was like, no, you can do it when you're younger as well.
You can. I mean, the profession, the research would say, or the statistics would say that we are an aged profession. I think I read something from the BACP saying the average age of a therapist is about 50. So, you know, but yeah, I think we need a variety of people in. Maybe it's easier to train as you get older, and maybe you've had one career and you're settling into another. But yeah, no, it's everybody should find their own style. And I, you know, I don't think I'd be everybody's cup of tea. I often laugh if I wonder how I'd go down if I started a practice in Harley Street in London. I'm sure I'd go down the storm with my Mancunian accent and my Noel Gallagher or my Liam Gallagher euphemisms. Probably not everybody's cup of tea, but I think it's something about therapists and clients finding each other and work with people who they can relate to. It's a relational work, you know.
Yeah, just like everyday life is. So much of counselling that you can apply to, you know, the fact that, you know, your friends, the people you work with, there's always going to be people that you're going to just have a better synergy with, and it's just the way it goes in this profession as well.
Yeah, and the research, you know, research done by John Norcroft up from Scranton University. That was a really good book out by Mick Cooper and John Norcroft about personalising psychotherapy. I'd recommend anybody buy it. Yeah. And one of the things they come up with is that the actual theory is about 15% of a positive outcome for clients. You know, the relationship and client motivation are big factors. It's called common factors, and it kind of makes sense. If you find someone who you can trust and you get along with and you like, you're more likely to feel comfortable with them. You're more likely to share what's going on for them, and you're more likely to get a positive outcome. It's not really rocket science.
No, was that 50% or 15% you said?
Sorry, 15.
Right,
so I've read varying, yeah, 15%, yeah. So it speaks to something that has not been known for years. Saul Rosenzweig in the 1800s talked about the dodo bird effect, and that comes from Alice in Wonderland. A short history of that is, all the animals in Alice in Wonderland's world had a race and everybody got prizes. And the reason that they talk about it in that in that light, is that everybody's equal. In other words, with very few exceptions, most theories really only apply 15% to a positive outcome. It's the relational factors and client motivation that add up quite a lot.
Yeah, because as somebody that's sought counselling as well, I know that obviously now I'm training to be a counsellor, I understand about the BACP ethical framework, being registered with a provider like BACP, having a qualification, because it isn't actually governed by law that you have to have trained to be a counsellor to say you're a counsellor. No. So, but as somebody just off the street, I would just go on online, and if somebody looked, I saw a picture of them, I read a bit about them, and I just thought, oh, I think I could see myself chatting to them. That was how I choose the counsellor. I would never go down and be like, oh, they've got such and such a continued personal development in X, Y, and Z and qualification in this. It was much more touchy-feely than that.
Could I tell people my innermost secrets? Yeah. Could I feel comfortable with that person? And you know, that is where therapy lives. It's where it lives, it breathes. And it's not something, you know, that can be taught. You know, and I'd like to say something about, you know, counsellor education. In the UK, it's a bit of a dog's dinner, to be honest, because there's loads of people offering counselling qualifications. I saw one on Groupon the other week, a weekend course, £9, nine UK pounds, and you become a counsellor, get a certificate. I'm thinking, I'll have a go of that. That sounds great. And there was another one, which was do a level 4 diploma in counselling. This was by an awarding body. It was online only, so there was no face-to-face or skills element to it. And at the end of it, you get a level 4 diploma in counselling. And this was the winner for me, to be honest, Ruth. And you got a free diary to put your appointments in. Now, come on. And it was only £800, and you could do it in modules. And as everybody knows, you know, you get your diploma in counselling from that course, you get your free diary, and then you go to get a job and you hand it over and they say, are you a member of an ethical body? And you go, no. And you try and join an ethical body and they say, without supervised hours, you can't join. It's worth nothing. And you can put in your diary, need to do another course. And
proper course, booking for a place, supervision.
So, yeah, if I can make a plea, any course should be, and in COVID times when we're recording this, it is difficult, but it should be ideally a course that would have run face to face. In other words, you would have gone to a class. Maybe they're online now, but if the COVID wasn't around, you would have actually gone to a class. You'd have actually sat in a classroom with your peers. And the course at practice level would be a minimum of 100 hours supervised practice at a placement. Without that, you have a qualification that is interesting, may have learnt a lot about theories, but it's not really a practice-based qualification. So my plea is, colleges, universities, private training providers, please, please, please do not be tempted to do a level 4 diploma in counselling with the, I better be careful in case I get sued, but, or you, because you're channel, in case you get sued.
Okay, yeah.
But with the, I'll make something up with the Institute of Counselling, Psychotherapy and All Great Knowledge online, you know, $49.99 as an offer. They're not worth the paper they've written on.
Yeah, so look out for one of the good providers. I mean, you know, I did my research and considered a master's, looked at locally to me, there's like Chester Uni, a few different options, Salford, and I ended up doing the CPCAB course because it was just the one that felt right to me. And I asked a few qualified counsellors that are in practice about what they thought, and they just said to me that they felt the CPCAB course was a really a good option for a diploma outside of a standard university course.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you some insight. You know, Counselling Tutor are great friends of CPCAB. We've been down to CPCAB. We know the crew at CPCAB. We talk regularly. We love them. We love everything about them and their ethos and their research-based ethos into producing qualifications. So we do speak highly of them. I mean, there's lots of other providers. What I would say is there is a choice when you start your counselling career. You can either go an academic route, which is university. Some people might like a university route where there's more in-depth theory. And some people may have a hankering to get a degree. You know, people might have the flat hat and the gown and all that caper. And then there's the kind of craft-based NVQ route that you see at colleges and private training providers, which really isn't as theory heavy, but gives you the insight and skills to be able to become a practitioner. And one of the things I would say is qualifications a good practitioner doesn't make. It comes down to those personal attributes, the desire to serve, the desire to help others. Those are the things that make a good counsellor, not the qualifications. They've gone down the tradition, they've gone down a suitable route.
Yeah, and like you say there, it's about knowing yourself, isn't it? Doing your research, not just jumping on some free diary and your online modules. Looking at kind of what do you want to do with it and what do you need for that? And then do you think that you want to go down that more academic route? For me, I'd already done a degree and I felt like I was a bit averse to going into something that was so academic, whereas I felt like I'd never done something more vocational. And that's just what felt right for me personally. Like, who knows? Yeah, I might want to do a degree in the future. I don't know, but we'll...
Who knows?
Yeah.
And, you know, if that's your destiny, then more power to your elbow. You know, and hats off to anybody who does a degree course, literally, because you do take your hat off, don't you, at the end of your degree? But I think if you want to, if you're thinking of training, really think about where your learning style is. Maybe if you're someone who is a second chancer like me, I didn't have any qualifications up to the age of about 41. Me in school, we didn't get on too well. There's lots of other things to be getting on with, and there's nothing really. It used to teach French and metalwork, and who wants a French metalworker, Ruth? Nobody. So I wasn't that invested in education. I came back in my 40s, and it was just this is the greatest thing. I used to go at every class going, I can't believe this. This is just, my tutor used to say, you just sit there smiling all the time. It's like, this is just great. And I'll never forget that. You know, I came out and it was like, wow, what an experience, you know. But it suited my learning style. It didn't stop me having most of my assignments referred, I seem to remember. But it was just that I felt I was learning. I felt I was a student. I felt that I could feel myself changing both personally and intellectually. Just a great experience. I sometimes think to myself, I'd love to be able to. I went back to teaching to try and capture some of that. It wasn't quite the same, but I think if I could have a time machine, I would definitely do it all again.
It's fab that you said that, because one of the things that I was listening to a podcast earlier on, it was with Russell Brand, just totally separate to this, and they were talking a little bit about how like recent times in particular, with the pandemic and everything, it makes you realise that you have to enjoy the moment you're in. And how much can we actually plan for, you know, having a 1 year plan, a 5 year plan? It's all nice to have an idea, but not to hold on to it too tight, because I think, especially with the counselling training, you know, it is sometimes a bit of a slog. It's great, but it can be emotionally taxing. And if you're so preoccupied with just rushing through your hours and ticking off assignments, you're not really kind of getting the learning and the, like you said, that joy that you can get, even though it can be hard sometimes. It also teaches you so much.
Yeah, it's like being in a band, I guess, isn't it? You gotta love playing the music and the vibe, and you know, and getting down with it all, as opposed to I've just got this set list to do and I get off, you know, get off home. And I think that's how learning should be. It should be like, you know, being in a bit of a punk rock band where you're saying, play this, no, not like this, like that, you know, and you can learn as you go along and you kind of riff along. And that really suits me. You know, I like the idea of kind of riffing and jamming and taking on ideas and using them. So yeah, it should be a real enjoyment. And you know, yeah, there are going to be times when you get your assignment back and or you may have a bit of a bump with a peer. But just try and enjoy the journey and keep in sight at all times that you're changing people's lives. What other occupation? It's two people sat in a room or online where your presence and just being you could change someone else's life. It's mind blowing. It's mind blowing.
Yeah, sounds simple, but it can be like some of the greatest things, isn't it? In its simplicity, it's what it can have so much power.
You're absolutely right. It's not always as easy as that, but I think if the ambition is to serve and help people, no matter what you do, not, you know, it could be in education, it could counselling education, it could be in anything in the area of mental health. I think it's a great and noble thing to do, and I'd take my hat off to anybody who does it. I really do.
And one of the other things, aside from the actual training itself, that I wanted to ask you about, which we've just kind of touched on, where you said about online in a room, which is, you know, for so long the model of psychotherapy, psychology, counselling. Yep. It's all been about either, you know, two people sat in a room, a couple and a therapist sat in a room, a family sat in a room, people sat together. And that feels like all of a sudden that model has been pulled into question. And I think that it's I just feel in me that amongst all the heartache and just rubbishness, if that's a word, of this current time.
This is now.
Yeah, rubbishness. That just the idea that I'm a little bit also excited about what could come out of the current times, in the sense that it's going to shake things up, I think, for counselling, and there's going to be a huge need for it. Well, there is right now. And so how do you think, well, the NHS and those like publicly funded services and the private sector, what do you think is going to happen in response to what's going on at the moment?
Okay, well, I can give you a personal view, and I can give you one that's done from some research that I'm doing.
Yeah.
Because I'm in the middle of writing a online supervision course specifically for people who work online. Little plug there, counsellingtutor.com for more details. nothing like a bit of a plug, is there? And I was doing some research around what we might be like post-lockdown. So I'm not saying post-COVID, because COVID's going to be with us forever now. It's not going to go away. We're going to be post-lockdown. And I think we're moving into quite a interesting time, both socially and economically. I don't think we've seen the true impact of COVID in terms of economics. And I think what will happen is that finances will drive how therapy is delivered. So the research that I was doing was exactly on, will practitioners come back into practice face to face after lockdown? And it's interesting, I found two bits of interesting research. One was from the EAP organization, which is an organization that oversees employment assistance programs. So a lot of counselors get work from EAPs. An EAP would be someone to whom maybe a HR department of an organization would refer someone to get them help. Or it may be that a charity may use an EAP, or a trade union may use an EAP as a way of getting help for someone who's having some, you know, emotional or mental difficulties. And they polled their members and they said that 58% would go back to a blended economy. I believe the BACP had polled there members, and they're saying about 69% had going to a blended economy where they do face-to-face in the room, as it's called, face-to-face and online. I also think that a lot of charities will look at economies of scale and say, well, we've got these buildings, but do we need them? Can we not do this online? I think the NHS might do that. One of the things that COVID has done, it's forced people online, and it's forced people to look at the sensibilities of, oh, it can't, it has to be in a room, it can't be. And then people have realised with the appropriate training that actually can build relationships online. I mean, look at us here. We're having a really good connected conversation, and you're 40 miles away from where I am. I feel connected. I don't know how you feel.
Yeah.
But yeah. So it speaks to that people have now experienced it, and yes, they think it works, and you know, there's all the savings. I don't have to travel. I don't have to hire a room. It speaks to client preferences. Remember, if you're taking 2 hours of your time to drive to your room, half an hour there, an hour in practice, half an hour back, then your client's using that time. So clients can be better accommodated. I think in terms of the economy, people will use online more and more. So I think it's here to stay. And I think that one of the big drivers of it will be economics, because, you know, room hire, room usage, time getting there and back, all of these we've seen you don't have to have now to have an online practice. So I think it's here to stay. And I think there will be some blended. I think people will go back. I also think this is a rather long answer to quite a simple question, isn't it?
That's brilliant.
I also wonder, as we have a significantly older cohort of people who are qualified counsellors, whether their risk analysis will come into that. I certainly wouldn't do, I'm due to have my vaccination in a few weeks, and I'm going to have my vaccination, folks. So no conspiracy theories at counselling towers, I'm just going to have it. And I would still be wary at my age of going back face-to-face. So I don't see myself ever going back. And I think I may speak to a group of people who are therapists who may think the same thing. I think older people have realised they're a bit more vulnerable. It's not going to go away. So it'd be interesting to see. I think younger people will probably be a little bit less risk averse, because younger people tend to be less risk averse. But I think our profession, you may find the older members of our profession prefer working online. But I may be speaking out of my hat, but that's my view on it.
It's really interesting to hear you talk about that, because I'm not young. I mean, I'm mid-30, so I'm not young, but I think it's interesting because I'm starting placement, which will be online, and I'm kind of really, really keen to be face-to-face with people. And my concern, which is not just born of counselling, it's of just life in general, is that, like, as much as online is brilliant and us having this conversation is great, and I think that to a certain extent it does meet that need for connection, because we can see each other, you can see someone's face, the mannerisms, that sort of thing. It's not like a text message service or a phone service. But I think there's something really powerful about being with someone physically, and I think that that's deeply rooted within us, and I'm concerned about that kind of getting taken over by tech, that tech is such a huge industry, and that they've pounced on COVID quite, you know, to be expected. We're in a capitalist society. It's an opportunity to make money. Zoom, who'd ever heard of Zoom before COVID? Yes. So it'll be interesting to see if there is also a kind of a rise in people that are willing to be like, no, I'm still face-to-face and you can still come and sit with me.
Yeah, and I think this is about client preferences, isn't it? This is about putting the clients at the forefront of our practice. and offering a choice if you feel you want to offer a choice. And you know, being upfront if you feel that you can only work online. I would be upfront if I was advertising my services and say, I work only online. Mm. And I do think there are some clients who'd want face-to-face work. So I think it is going to be a mixed economy. I also think it opens the opportunity up to work out of your area. So, you know, I used to supervise someone in London. I supervised people from all over the country. And I do that by the use of online telecommunications like we're using now. So, and I counsel that way as well. So I think it's about client preferences. It's about, you know, how therapists feel. And also I think, you know, the economics of it are going to play a big part. I certainly think within charities, because they've now adapted to working online. And I would take you back to Carl Rogers sitting in the 1950s in Chicago, where he had his training school, buying these very expensive tape recorders and recording clients and them all huddling around making notes and this new technology. And I'm sure there were those who said, oh, you know, what's all this fangled technology? And, you know, Rogers changed the face of therapy forever. And I was reading, in fact, I've quoted from Rogers in the supervision course, Rogers saying that, you know, from, you know, the Chinese symbol for catastrophe is the same as opportunity. It's just how it's framed. And I think that, I think the online world will flourish. But I do take your point that it's a personal thing, and some practitioners will return. And maybe, you know, in 10 years, if we get to interview again, maybe they'll be teaching about how to work with someone in the room as opposed to online. They might be doing a special course of working with someone sat in the room course.
Yeah, I believe anything's possible. And I love that you mentioned about Carl Rogers, because from what I understand, you'll probably know the ins and outs better than me, but like person-centered therapy and types of counselling that we often see now, like my course is integrative, so its foundation is person-centered, but we also do some psychodynamic practice and CBT. But Carl Rogers is a big force in person-centered therapy of my training. And to know that it was sort of out of the back of World War II and like so much trauma and people that needed people that were skilled in listening and could use the person-centered skills, that's how that came about. So it'd be interesting to see if this is kind of another ripple like that where the will transform.
Yeah, I think if you're talking about World War II, you might be better placed to cite Byrne, Eric Byrne, who's the founder of TA, because he actually worked with people who were veterans and had to diagnose them very quickly. Hence, TA being a very the original transactional analysis being a very cognitive behavioural model. It was about the ego states. It wasn't particularly in the original school. It wasn't about that. Rogers was more about our development as children. Remember, he worked at the Rochester Children's Institute.
Yeah.
And he had a good foundation in understanding how childhood experience impacted on adult behavior. But yeah, a newly industrialized society, one that's having a change of economics, is going to cause mental health problems. In fact, it's well documented that industrialized societies have higher incidence of mental health issues, higher rates of it than other countries. I think we're the second highest in the world after America. So right. it's not a great statistic to be known for as a country, is it?
No, and I think one of the things that you said in different types of society and industrialization and all these mass scale changes take us away from that model of where, you know, previously we would have had religion as a focal point, you would have lived in a smaller community, stayed close to those close family ties. And, and I think as all of those things change, it's bound to bound to affect how we feel and the support systems that we've got around us. And I'd be interested to see if group support grows from the current situation, because I think the power of being a new mum and having a baby in the middle of all this, I can see how the peer support, somebody who's really experienced, say a trained counsellor or somebody who's worked in mental health, being able to hold a space for people to come together in a group can also be really powerful. And that's something that I feel there's a lot of value in that as well. It's not for everyone. Like you say, some people don't feel comfortable, but I know Ruby Wax does this thing called frazzled cafes, and she's taken it online during COVID, where you just coming together as somebody that's got a mental health issue, and you're having a cup of tea and a chat with other people, and you're all just there saying, you know, we're frazzled, things aren't going quite that well at the moment, and that peer group supports you.
Absolutely. And I think one of the things we're not really great at in Western society, we're getting better at it in the time I've been involved in mental health, is actually saying, I've got an issue, I've got a problem. And people rallying around and saying, you know, how can we help? I think we're getting better at that. And I think, you know, I think inevitably in societies, I think young people are leading the way with that. You know, that young people are more likely than maybe people in my generation to kind of admit to their mental health problems, you know. And I think it's sad that the media sometimes lambast people for being, you know, a bit weak. I think it's a great strength to say, I'm not coping very well, I need some help. And for somebody to come along and say, you know, put the metaphorical arm around you and say, well, you know, okay, let's listen to what's going on for you. It's really, really, really important. And let's hope that continues. Let's hope that, you know, people come together to do that. I think that it's as effective, I think, as one-to-one counselling sometimes.
Yeah. And I think what you said about something I'm interested in is this snowflake thing that young people who are, I would say, overall more in touch with their mental health. And, you know, there's a lot to be said, and I'm not saying that I'm biased against that view, but the idea that, you know, to be able to express that you've got some mental health issues or that you feel sensitive, that's something that's come more to the fore now. And the older generation are like, oh, they're all snowflakes. But is it more that we're living in a system and a society that is out of tune with our emotions and our needs? So
I could do a whole other podcast on that. I think that I would always stick to the model of how we think equals how we feel equals how we behave equals how we live our lives. And I think that, and I speak as someone who's 63, so we meet the dinosaur. I think there's great value in teaching our children resilience. So I've got a couple of grandchildren. Jacob is 5, and he bangs his head. And if he bangs his head, he'll come to me and I'll rub it. I say, oh, that must hurt. I rub it better. See, all right, yeah, go and play. And I think that we are moving into a society where people ruminate on being offended.
Oh, definitely.
And I say to people, someone said to me the other day, I'm offended about that. And I said, have you taken the offence? And they've gone, yes. I said, well, don't take it. It's simple, isn't it? Don't take it. I said, I wasn't giving you as the offensive thing, so don't take it. If you saw a football that was covered in mud, would you pick it up? Well, no. Why not? Well, I get my hands dirty. My point proven correctly. Don't take it. And I think one of the reasons, and I'll probably get a load of mail in my mailbag and your comments on YouTube now, but I think one of the reasons our children struggle with their mental health is that we don't teach them resilience. We don't say, you know, and I'm not saying sticks and stones may break my bones, but what we don't say is we don't think about the thinking first. And I think that's something that we have to teach our children. We have to teach our children, and certainly I teach my grandchildren, certainly my daughter, that, you know, you have to be cognitive first. And yeah, if someone's hurt, if someone's said something that's hurt your feelings, have a think why that is, but actually think about how you can alter that. And of course it speaks to CBT, but I think we're moving into an epoch where adolescence is stretching out, because young people are not going through the rites of passage that my generation went through, such as full-time jobs, such as buying their own houses, such as certainty in lots of areas. And when you have that undertow of uncertainty, then of course it's going to affect people's mental health. But I do think that we need to teach resilience, and we need the right to offend, because that's how we get thinking done. If you're saying an idea and someone says I'm offended by that, if you audit yourself, that means that there's no debate. And I think in a public square, going off counselling now, we really need to have that real conversation where if someone says I'm offended, well, you may be offended, but as Evelyn Beatrice Hall said, quoting Voltaire, I may not agree with what you say, but I defend to the death your right to say it. I think if you take offence, then you've taken it. It's not usually given. May not be a very popular thing. I'll probably get a lot of letters in the mailbag now, but
I think just you acknowledging that sometimes there's that fear of now saying things that may be a little bit controversial. And I really do agree with what you're saying about building that emotional resilience and not trying to hide things from children and young people.
Yeah.
And from each other, you know, there will be things that happen in life that you will fall over, both physically and mentally. Things will happen outside of your control. People will have completely different views to you. And if you choose to shield your children from all of that, and you also choose to just not have a dialogue with people that you don't agree with, then where does that leave us? I mean, I always think that we're collaborative people.
Absolutely.
And I think
I'm not saying that people should, I've got no time for people who go out to be deliberately cruel or deliberately hurtful or bullying. I've got no time for that. But I do think that we need to think about, people make mistakes, people may have different ideas. And I think one of the things, if I meet someone who's got a different idea to me, I don't take offence. So tell me where you got that idea from. What informs that idea? Let's find the common ground, as opposed to immediately. I mean, I was called, someone posted on our Facebook page, said that I was white, which I thought was interesting. I mean, 10 out of 10 for observation. But, you know, how come people in Counselling Tutor are all white? And the answer to that question is, our team's a very diverse team. It just happens that I was born that way. Mm. And I just thought it was an interesting comment. And you can understand why people get exercised by it. And we live in a state of flux about, you know, where identity lives within each of us and how identity is informed, you know, prejudice. And I fully accept that. But I do think that sometimes we need just to have a sensible conversation and respect each other's views. You can't do that if you're auditing yourself.
No, and I think it comes down to empathy, which was one of the main parts of counselling. And I know now they're trying to educate young children and through like gamification. I heard some the other day that there's computer games now where instead of just shooting the bad guy or killing the bad guy, you try and understand his backstory and why he's doing the things he or she, you know, tends to be a man. There you go. Why he's doing that. And I think that having that empathy, which you learn a lot about on counselling training, is key to it. It's like, you know, trying to understand, well, why do you have that view and what does that make you feel and how does that help you? And then you can kind of then begin to really understand that there's a lot of similarities with people that we're often all just trying to get needs met, like you said at the beginning, just doing it in sometimes different ways.
We need to find the common ground with everybody we disagree with as a point of reference. And empathy is a great place to start with that. and to be able to, for every angry person I've ever met, I've also met someone who's been wronged. I've also met people who have been marginalized or dismissed or physically attacked, and to find the common ground and to use empathy, I think is really, really important. You know, and I think the world is better for having people who are empathic, who try and understand someone else's frame of reference. There are times when you have to act, of course. You know, if someone's thumping me, I may not be that empathic, but all behaviour is goal directed, you know. And I don't mean to come across as someone who supports cruelty or unkindness. But I think we need to know where the, I think we need to know where the barrier's drawn, and we need to keep, our society was built on debate. It was built on dialogue. Relationships are built on that. We need to keep that going. Definitely. Yeah.
Well, it's been fascinating speaking to you. I feel like we've gone off on some different tangents, but, like, you know, everything is related to the counselling room, I feel. And yes. While I was talking about, like, the practicalities of the course and other things, it's interesting to, really good to hear your thoughts about that there are really good opportunities for people that are in counselling training for the right reasons, and in the current climate, as long as you're open and you're flexible about how things are going to go, it's going to be an interesting time, like you say, to see how therapy moves on and shifts and changes.
We are at a crossroads in understanding mental health from a neurological point of view, from a psychological point of view, from a societal point of view. All these are now coming together to get a real good roadmap of what constitutes mental health and how we communicate that and communicate with each other. There's no better time to be a therapist, no better time. And one final plea before I go. You know, be in service of people, try and see their frame of reference, try and be kind where you can.
Yeah, kindness, I think, is I heard somebody say recently, there's far too many clever people in the world, too many people trying to be clever, and not enough people knowing that being kind is more needed in some ways. Yeah,
it's better to be right, it's better to be kind than right.
Yes. That is a very good, beautiful ending to the conversation. And thanks so much, Rory, because, like I say, I just want to say thank you to you, because I've watched so much of your videos that you've put on YouTube, and I found them massively, massively helpful in keeping me going on my learning when I've really had to, like, dig in and didn't quite get something. You've made it, you know, much more easy for me to understand, and I know many others as well. And what I'll do is below, I'll put links to the Counselling Tutor website, where people can find out about all the other offerings that you've got. And like you say, your book and your mailing list, so that people can keep up to date with what Counselling Tutor's doing and the research and different things you've got to offer.
Yeah, and thank you. You're the future of our profession. People like you, Ruth, and the people you sit in the circle with, you're the future of our profession, and this interview tells me that our profession's in safe hands, so thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Rory. Thank you.